The view that posterity has had of St. Cyril is certainly not of him as a pastor in the first instance, which is not to say that he was not a pastor. His pastoral, and for that matter his personal self, had been overshadowed by his reputation as a formidable politician, polemicist, and exegete, and the sources we have at our disposal in principle do not dwell on him as pastor. As I mentioned earlier, we have no hagiographical life of St. Cyril, only a few edifying stories of contemporary or near contemporary sources. A story from Abba Daniel in the Apophthegm of Patrum relates how, in a very tactful way, Cyril steered a monk away from an erroneous opinion. An anonymous source, probably from the 5th or 6th century, called the History of Dioscorus, prominently features Athanasius and Cyril as the inspiring models for Dioscorus, Cyril's successor as Patriarch of Alexandria, who was anathematized and exiled after the Council of Chalcedon. There are also stories from St. Sophronius, Patriarch of Jerusalem, in connection with Cyril's founding of the shrines of St. Cyrus and John, painting Cyril as, I quote, a good shepherd. St. Cyril's fame increased exponentially after the Council of Chalcedon, when both sides of the fence claimed him for their Christological pedigrees. Lionel Whitman assesses Cyril's theological influence as follows. The patristic understanding of the incarnation owes more to Cyril of Alexandria than to any other individual theologian. Professor McGovern goes further in stating that Cyril, I quote, is surely one of the Church's greatest intellectual thinkers in terms of Christology and Trinitarianism, and one of the most powerful of the early Greek exegetes. However, there is another side to the picture of Cyril, which we all know about, in which he is seen as a bully, and even as, in one source, I quote, an ecclesiastical thug. A view which, no doubt, goes much to his presumed implication in the murder of Hypatia and his somewhat overweening assumption of the presidency of the Council of 431. Cyril's perceived claim as a touchstone of post-Chalcedonian orthodoxy has been overestimated in some modern scholarship, which attributes, for example, the Christology of Severus of Antioch directly to the influence of Cyril, to the extent that Severus has been seen as a kind of second Cyril. More balanced readings indicate, however, that at least in exegetical terms, Severus was far more a disciple of Don Chrysostom. Then again, the slipperiness of Cyril's dogmatic stance, depending on whether he was polemicizing against Arians or Nestorians, left a confused legacy in the debate after the Council of Chalcedon. In the late Cardinal Brillmeyer's words, the historical development of Cyril was in fact so ambivalent that his works could become a common arsenal for contrary Christologies, depending upon what one sought in them. Here, of course, the Cardinal was referring in the first instance to Cyril's initial anti-Arian and anti-Apollinarian stance, and to his subsequent anti-Nestorian position. Now, it would not be fitting, at the conclusion of this discussion of St. Cyril's pastoral role, to issue him with a report card, as our journalists are used to doing so deliberately with our politicians. Suffice it to say that, in contrast with many other Episcopal shepherds in late antiquity, St. Cyril's pastoral side does not come to the fore in either his own writings or those of his contemporaries. We think, by contrast, of Basil of Caesarea and his letters and spiritual writings, the several letters of Augustine of Hippo with pastoral content, the letters of recommendation and intercession which the orator Cyrus composed, as well as his Historia Religiosa, a collection of spiritually instructive and edifying tales, pastoral letters of Severus of Antioch, the popular moral preaching of Caesarius of Arles, and the vast collection of letters of Gregory I of Rome, embodying a macrocosm of information on various topics from the pastoral to pastoral micromanagement, as well as his seminal work, The Regular Pastoralis. of the seven criteria for pastoral care, which I outlined at the beginning of this paper, it will become clear that St. Cyril excelled in three and four, those of conversion and the maintenance of orthodoxy, while in the others, we do not have enough evidence to pass a responsible judgment on his role as pastor. So, exegete, most definitively, and par excellence. Politician, most certainly. Pastor, the jury must remain out. Thank you.